Good afternoon. I want to thank you for joining us for lunch. My name is Tim Nicholson, a Senior Marketing Manager for Toshiba America Medical Systems. I want to thank you for joining us once again and thank the ASHNR for allowing Toshiba to sponsor this lunch presentation. I have the pleasure to introduce our presenter, Dr. Keith Peters. Dr. Peters is Associate Professor at the Department of Radiology at the University of Florida College of Medicine. Dr. Peters is going to present today on his experience using Toshiba's 320 detector row CT scanner, Aquilion 1. Unfortunately, Dr. Peters is on a really tight schedule, so if you do have some questions and we don't have time to answer them, we'd like to invite you to the Toshiba booth, which is right behind us in the exhibit area. We can help you answer those questions, and if we cannot, we can get you in contact with Dr. Peters. Thanks, Dr. Peters.
Thank you, and thanks for having me. And this is a luncheon session, so we're a little bit more laid back and relaxed than some of the scientific presentations. So we'll try to approach it from a very informal standpoint. The concepts are going to be somewhat different from regular perfusion type imaging that you're used to. Some of the concepts and mathematics are a little bit different, but from a group that's used to knowing the anatomy and physiology of head and neck compartmental disease, this is cake relative to what you do on a daily basis. I really want to just dive into it and get everybody's feet wet with sort of what the technology looks like, how it differs from perfusion imaging that that you do on a daily basis. And to start off with, we're going to look at a 71-year-old gentleman, status post-cardiac arrest. He had been in the hospital for multiple surgeries over the prior 2 months and was in rehab at this particular point in time and had a persistent hemothorax. He was being discharged from the rehab facility and had acute onset of right hemi body weakness. This is what his 3D CT, 4D actually, CT angiogram demonstrates. And you can see that he has occlusion of the left middle cerebral artery, acute truncation. He's got persistent patency of the anterior temporal branch and a little bit of leptomeningeal collateral coming in through the lateral convexity region. He then underwent perfusion imaging. And again, this guy had acute onset. He was being discharged. He was within time limits allowed for treatments. And the maps are very different on what you will see with whole brain perfusion imaging off of the Toshiba 320 system, otherwise known as the Aquilion 1. The key aspect, I mean, starting out, we've got our standard reference map, volume, time to peak, delay, mean transit time, and flow maps. This is the standard layout. There'll be some that we'll be looking at that have slightly different color bars inverted, but those are just different iterations of the software. Of key note is the difference with this. It is known as SVD plus. SVD is the standard algorithm. It's called singular valued decomposition. And the plus stands for the fact that this is delay insensitive. Most algorithms that we look at for mean transit time include the delay for the time of contrast to get there. So if you've got an acute occlusion, you're using leptomeningeal collaterals to get there, you're using even anterior communicating, posterior communicating, it's going to take longer for blood to get there. That particular time is included in many of the vendor MTT maps. And Kudo had a really nice paper several months ago that showed differences between various vendor maps. They are really across the board, very vendor specific at this point in time. But the key point with the 320 and its processing system is that that delay, which we see represented in this map, is separated out so that what we're really seeing on the MTT map is hopefully a true representation of what MTT is supposed to mean, which is the capillary transit time. And just of note, what we're seeing on this is he does have a very long delay in the perfusion into the entire MCA territory. But when we look at it, the territory that's really decreased and where the capillary bed seems to be hurting is a small area, immediately periventricular, and also getting a little bit more toward the lateral convexity region. Otherwise, we're not looking at a very huge territory. He was not a candidate for thrombolytics due to the hemothorax and the recent surgeries, so he was taken to the endovascular suite. And here you can see what he looked like at baseline angiography. Again, a complete truncation here, and then anterior temporal branch filling. A microwire was able to go across the lesion. Penumbra was attempted. Mercy was attempted. No clot retrieval could be obtained. Then under an IRB-approved protocol for stent deployment, a stent was deployed and got very good TIMI recanalization into that vascular bed. And here you can see very good distal reperfusion. Now, this is an examination of what he looked like as far as the CT scan 5 days post-injury. And you can see in that high posterior MCA territory, he does have persistent effacement of the sulci. Periventricular, he has a focal area of infarction. And this all correlates very nicely with the MTT maps. And this is what we're seeing as a very close correlation. There are different studies that demonstrate whether CBV or CBF, what should be the landmark that we should be using. From our anecdotal evidence right now, we're leaning very heavily toward the MTT, and we're starting studies to look at that. Now, this is my relationship to knowing a little bit more about how this technology works. This was me back on June 20. I was out for a normal, lovely Sunday morning bike ride, and I fell down and went boom. And this is what my shoulder did. It popped out, fracture off the greater tuberosity. The things that this image doesn't tell you is how bad this hurts. Between the fracture, the dislocation, and impingement of the axillary nerve, hurt like heck. And the second thing is to try to get your films out of Shands University of Florida, if they're your own, for meeting purposes, the paperwork you got to go through. They underwent an non-operative reduction and had a very nice result. And this is what I looked like that very day following the reduction. You can see that I want to have a nice Hill-Sachs deformity here, but everything looked like it was in very good alignment. But unfortunately, following about 2 weeks later, the plane films were showing some potential slight migration, and there was discrepancy between the MSK readers whether they felt it had slipped, and considering this was a highly comminuted fracture, there was concern about what the treatment would be. So we underwent CT scanning to see what was going on, and the thing that may or may not project well, but the reason I included this, the one thing that astounded us, this image was done on the 64 slice scanner, a Toshiba, which is very reliable, and this was done on the 320 as a single volume. And the trabecular pattern recognition was phenomenal. There is a night and day difference between the two. The detector system that's used in the 320, we're used to seeing high visualization of the vascular bed, but here we're seeing stuff down at the trabecular level, which really does indicate how sensitive the detector system is. And things have evolved over the years. When I started back in med school and residency, we were back on planar imaging. What you sliced is what you got. You really couldn't do much more with it. Then we got into the whole concept of volume imaging and helical scanning, which I think were suspect initially, but is what we live by nowadays. But this is the next step, temporal volume metric, where we get 4D, we can look at an entire volume and follow it over time. Just to compare apples and apples, this is looking at the AQ64 from Toshiba. What we consider about it, it seems a very, very reliable system. It's got great resolution. We can acquire, reconstruct, and transfer the data very quickly, and we'll look at the actual times in a second. And the radiation doses, from our standpoint, have been very acceptable over the years. The limitations were we can only do a 4-centimeter slab. And we get some venous contamination. Sometimes that's difficult to separate the arteries and the veins, and also dural fistulas, which we'll be looking at. This is how the system works. The area that's being evaluated is within a single volume, and we keep scanning this volume over and over. A contrast dose is injected. We scan very rapidly during the early sequence when we're trying to get the arterial phase. And then we keep monitoring through the venous phase at a slower rate so that we can map out arterial and venous anatomy. Additionally, this allows us over the scan time of a total of 60 seconds to look at the perfusion. So we're able to get whole brain perfusion and whole brain angiography, arterial, capillary, venous in one single second study. And then we're able to get the reconstructions, looking at the arteries, veins, and the perfusion maps. Again, it's one single acquisition. Straight out of the box, this is what the Aquilian one came to us as when we got it a little over a year ago. And this sort of portrays in more of a diagrammatic fashion what happens. We're scanning, we give a delay in time just for allowing contrast to get to the head and neck region, and then we scan every other second during the arterial phase and then switch for the venous phase to about once every 5 seconds. It was run at 80 kV and 100 mA. It gave great whole brain perfusion. The anatomical detail in the vasculature wasn't quite what our neurosurgeons were used to. And so we worked with Toshiba and with other sites that had AQ1s in place, and this MA boost was developed. And this really answered most of our concerns. During the time when there's primary flow through the circle of Willis region, we go to a higher MA, now to 300 actually, and baseline we run at 150 mA, and this is able to markedly improve our overall vascular detail and vascular resolution. You'll note that there's one other thing which does play into overall appearance and radiation doses. This very first peak is set at a slightly higher level, 310, just so it can be recognized. And this is the volume that's subtracted off of everything to give us our DSA-like appearance. So we run through initially at a lower dose, come through a little bit higher to get our vascular resolution, and then go back to a decreased dosage for the remainder of the imaging study.